Do I ask the question, who is that God? Is he personal? Is he knowable? Can I connect with him? If so, how? That is the trail we have to pursue. Now, if we are indifferent, we won't follow the trail. If we are intellectually lazy, we won't follow the trail.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of the Spirit, washed in his blood. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And all is at rest. I am my Savior, I'm happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. Yeah, this. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior. All the day long, and all the day long,
my Jesus.
I'm gonna praise
my Jesus.
In Paul's beloved book, Romans, he makes some tough,
unashamed statements about salvation, God's sovereignty, judgment, and God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a foundation for their faith. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character? Today's message is called The Wrath of God.
I want to read to you from Romans chapter 1. I'm going to begin reading at verse 18. This is one of the most sober passages in the whole of Scripture. If you don't have your own Bible, I recommend you use one from the pews there and that you keep it open as we look at what Paul has to say here. Verse 18 of Romans 1. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. For though they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal men and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. Amen. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even the women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. Furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, he gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. When you go to visit your doctor, the first and most important task that they have is to make an accurate diagnosis of your presenting symptoms. If the diagnosis is wrong, then the remedy is going to be wrong. And we probably don't need to argue about the presenting symptoms of our society and of our world, for they're exposed to us in our news bulletins every night and splashed across our newspapers. But the question is, what is the underlying disease? What is actually wrong with our world? And is there a remedy? In his letter to the Romans, Paul presents a diagnosis of the human condition in the first 2.5 chapters, before then offering in the rest of the book a comprehensive remedy. And last week we looked at verse 17, which was our key verse, that says, "For in the gospel a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last." But today, our key verse is the next verse, verse 18, Well, Paul writes, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Now, notice that both are being revealed. The righteousness of God is revealed, and that is in the past tense. It has been revealed to us. But now he says the wrath of God is being revealed. As I'll make clear a little bit later, that is in the present tense. It is being revealed. But both the righteousness of God and the wrath of God can only be known by the revelation of the Spirit of God. Now, I want to talk today about the wrath of God. This is an important issue, not least because it is a very difficult issue. For many of us, it gives God a bad name. Often as Christians, we feel that the wrath of God is something about which we either keep extremely silent or we need to make an apology and explain how it's not really wrath, but something much nicer than that. It's just unfortunate that wrath is a bad word. And maybe some hackles here this morning are already being aroused by the fact that I'm introducing this theme. We fear that wrath is not consistent with God's love or with his kindness. I looked up in my Oxford Dictionary a definition of wrath that defines it as extreme anger. So I looked it up in Webster to see if Webster could make it a little softer. But they don't. They make it even harder. They define wrath as strong, vengeful anger or indignation. There's no way to soften this word. It means what it means. But is this a blotch on the character of God, or is in some way this a part of his love? Is this a part of his holiness? And I want this morning that we very humbly try to understand what Paul writes here. I say very humbly because it's not pleasant. And we need in humility to seek to understand what is being said. He talks about two things. He talks about the provocation of God's wrath. On what grounds is God's wrath provoked? And I want you to look carefully at Paul's argument, because in verse 18 and 19, he says, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. Now notice, the issue is not in itself the wickedness of the people, but that they suppress the truth by their wickedness. It is the suppression of truth that is the real issue. In verse 21, he says, although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Here's the problem. They knew God. We'll see why he says that in a moment. But they did not act accordingly and give thanks to him, which is the natural response to recognizing God. Verse 25 says, they exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and they worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator. In other words, they traded in the truth for a lie. They exchanged the truth Verse 28 says, furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, he gave them over. They had a knowledge of God, but they did not retain it. So the issue that Paul addresses is not intellectual. It's not a question of ignorance. It is volitional. It is a question of their will turning away from God. But that begs a very big question. If he says, as he does several times, that people suppress the truth, although they know God, they don't respond to him, they exchange the truth for a lie, they don't retain knowledge of God, the question that begs is, how is it that God has revealed himself so clearly that Paul says people are without excuse in verse 20? Well, there are two ways that he speaks about. One here in chapter 1, and then we'll look into chapter 2 at something he says there. First of all, he says God has revealed himself in creation. Now that's in verse 20. For he says, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. This is what we may call a natural revelation of God that is available in creation to anyone who will open their eyes and then believe what they see and then follow it through to its logical cause, where he says they will find God. Now, of course, we respond by saying, come on, that is naive in the extreme. To say simplistically, the creation reveals the Creator is naive. But actually, it is profoundly important. It is the most simple and the most logical explanation for the universe that we're part of, and the most logical argument for our existence. There have been arguments presented throughout history for the existence of God that rely not on the Bible or God's revelation, but upon what is naturally available to any thinking and reasoning person. There's first what we call the cosmological argument. And the cosmological argument says that every effect must have a cause. See, rest is a natural state. Motion is an unnatural state. There's something behind motion. There doesn't have to be something behind rest. You know, this pulpit here is stationary right now. That is entirely natural. None of us are thinking about it because it's the most natural thing in the world. But if suddenly this pulpit began to move across the stage, you'd all stop listening to me and say, what in the world is making that happen? Is there a piece of string somebody's pulling? Are there some wheels on it somehow? Is there some kind of magnetic pull that's pulling it along? Because to be stationed like this is totally natural, doesn't need any explanation, but to be moving, we'd all want to know what is the reason for it. If suddenly tomatoes began pelting me, we'd look up into the balcony and see who's throwing them. Because tomatoes don't spontaneously start hitting people. Somebody's behind them. And in the way that pulpits don't move across the stage without having a cause behind it, and tomatoes don't come flying through the air without a cause, Paul's argument is very simple. Wake up and be sensible. There's a reason behind everything you see. That's not foolish. That's not stupidity. That's intelligence. Then there is the teleological argument. And that's an argument from design, because the world reveals intelligence, order, harmony, purpose. And that implies that it exists for a purpose. And it exists for an intelligent, not a random existence, but for intelligent purpose. And therefore, there is a being adequate to the production of such a world that lies behind it. Be a very remarkable thing if a hurricane blew through a junkyard and stirred it all up, and when the hurricane had passed by and all the junk had settled, it left behind a Boeing 747 jumbo jet that was capable of flying. Wouldn't that be rather remarkable? Well, that's about the level of the intricacy and marvel of the world we live in if this is purely fluke. And if there is no intelligent design, it is fluke. The issue then that Paul is writing about here is not do we have a revelation of God, but do we suppress the logic of that revelation? Do we refuse to give thanks, he says, to God? Do we exchange the truth for a lie? That's in verse 25. They failed to retain the knowledge of God in verse 28. But though we might suppress it and refuse it and exchange it and not retain it, it is there, is his argument. Abraham Lincoln, I confess, is my favorite American president. And he once wrote this: I never gaze at the stars without feeling that I am looking into the face of God. I can see how it might be possible for a man to look down upon the earth and be an atheist, but I cannot conceive how he could look up into the sky and say, there is no God. You might say that is naive, that is simplistic, that is kindergarten thinking. That is unsophisticated, that is unscientific. You would, of course, be wrong, though you might think that. The fact remains, creation reveals a creator. And so Paul writes in verse 19, what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. Now notice, Paul doesn't say everybody knows Christ that way. They don't. Or everybody's heard the gospel. That's not true. But everybody has had a revelation of God, and the issue is, do I follow the trail that opens up to me? And do I ask the question, who is that God? Is he personal? Is he knowable? Can I connect with him? If so, how? That is the trail we have to pursue. Now, if we are indifferent, we won't follow the trail. If we are intellectually lazy, we won't follow the trail. But there is a revelation of God at the starting gate, which, if followed, leads along a path to knowing God. But they didn't follow through, and so he says in verse 21, although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. That's not following it through. And this is what happened, and their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools, and they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. Very simply, when we don't respond to him thankfully, which is acknowledging him and our dependence on him, our thinking becomes foolish, our hearts become darkened, We claim to be becoming wise. In actual fact, we are becoming fools. And our folly rapidly descends, he says, into verse 23, where they're exchanging the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal men, birds, animals, and reptiles. And inevitably, we sink into idolatry. It was G.K. Chesterton who said, when people stop believing in God, they don't believe in nothing, they believe in anything. Do you know you can go to any city in the world at any time in its history, whether it's primitive or sophisticated, and you may not see great industry in every place, and you may not see great centers of learning in every place, and you may not see the accumulation of wealth in every place, but you will see the evidence of worship. You will see the temple, or the shrine, or the mosque, or the church, or the idols. And if we've crushed those with our sense of sophistication or our political correctness, we will replace them with sporting stars, rock stars, film stars, heroes, and we will create a celebrity culture because we have to have somebody bigger than ourselves. And we will worship. You see, the fingerprint of God is all around and in our lives. If we suppress that truth about God, if we refuse to give thanks to Him, it leads, says Paul, to spiritual, moral, and behavioral bankruptcy. And if that is unchecked, it becomes, in verse 29, wicked, greedy, and depraved. So Paul's charge is not they didn't know anything about God, but that they failed to acknowledge and follow through what they knew. That's his charge. Now, if God has revealed himself in creation, he has also revealed himself in conscience. Creation is out there. It's objective to us. Conscience is in here. It is subjective. Look at people who have no revelation of God in any objective way. They've never been given the law of God. They actually have it written in their hearts. There's a sense of right, there's a sense of wrong, there's a sense of good, there's a sense of bad that is embedded in the heart of the human race. It can become damaged, of course. It can become distorted. But it is intrinsic to us. It's what we call natural law, a law that's known by nature and it's universal. That's why children know injustice very early. They recognize it. Children have an acute sense of fairness and of fair play. They know kindness when they see it. They know right and they know wrong. And we have this inbuilt knowledge that is evidence of the moral character of God that is within us. And though sometimes evil does seem to dominate in our world, this natural law will bring it back to something better. So the killing fields of Pol Pot in Cambodia could not survive. The exploitation of colonialism could have its fling for about a century and then collapse. The oppression of communism survived 60 or 70 years. North Korea cannot survive in its present oppression. Morally, it cannot survive. The natural law will correct itself in due course. We're seeing that in Syria. We've seen it in Libya, other parts of the world. And We are aware of this natural moral law. The requirements of the law are written in our hearts. So Paul's charge is this. The people have turned a blind eye to creation, and they've turned a deaf ear to conscience. And as a consequence, they're under the wrath of God. What do we mean by that? That's the provocation of God's wrath. Let me talk secondly about the expression of God's wrath. And I pointed out earlier that he speaks in the present tense of verse 18, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men. How is God's wrath expressed? Does he zap us? Does he destroy us? No, it is much more subtle and more devastating in its consequences than that. There's a phrase that reoccurs three times in these verses where Paul says that God gave them over. In verse 24, therefore God gave them over in the simple desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. Verse 26, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Verse 28, he gave them over to depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. Do you know how God expresses his wrath? He gives us over to the logical end of our own choices. God's judgment on us is he lets us go our own way. He speaks of three areas specifically in these verses. He talks about what he calls sexual impurity. First of all, in verse 24, therefore God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity and for the degrading of their bodies with one another. And what is God's judgment on sexual immorality? He will let you go. His wrath is he will hand you over. He doesn't send thunderbolts to destroy us. He hands you over. You know, if there's somebody here this morning and you're engaged in an illegitimate sexual relationship, God's not going to strike you down. He won't make your car crash on the way to a secret rendezvous. You may crash purely coincidentally, but he won't make it happen. You may get there safely and come home safely, and he will let you go. He will let you go. There's a case in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 of a man who was engaged in a sexual relationship with his father's wife. Clearly not his mother, but his stepmother. And this man had been warned about this, and Paul tells them to hand this man over to Satan. Same phrase. God gives us over, hand him over into the territory which he describes as satanic that he has chosen. Let him live his sexually immoral life, Paul says. And in verse 27 here, back in Romans 1, he talks then about them receiving in themselves the due penalty for their perversions. God's wrath is he'll let you do it, and you'll pay the price. And so will other people. Let me point out carefully to you Paul's argument of how this comes about. He uses the word exchange several times in this passage. In verse 23, he says, they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images. Verse 25, they exchanged the truth of God for a lie. In verse 27, women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. Verse 27, men abandoned, same meaning, exchanged natural relations with women for men. Verse 28, Furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, they exchanged it. Notice that the exchange of the glory of God for images, the exchange of the truth of God for a lie, becomes the exchange of sexual morality for sexual immorality. Here's the logic. If we are created to be in God's image, and we talked about this last time, then we only know what humanity is to be like if we know what God is like, because we were made in his moral likeness. That is logical. If we're in his image, we only know what we're to be like if we know what God is like. But if we do not know what God is to be like, we therefore do not know what humanity, if we don't know what God is like, we don't know what humanity is to be like. We exchange what is natural behavior for what is unnatural. And then we consider the unnatural normal. Stuart Briscoe, writing about this passage, has said this. He says, confusion about deity leads to confusion about humanity. And confusion about humanity leads to confusion about identity. And confusion about identity gives rise to confusion about sexuality. In other words, if you get deity wrong, you'll get humanity wrong. You get humanity wrong, you'll get your identity wrong. Get your identity wrong, you'll probably get your sexuality wrong. And sexual breakdown, the sexual breakdown of our day, as of the Roman Empire, is an inevitable consequence of spiritual breakdown that exchanges the truth of God for the only alternative, which whatever flavor it is a lie. Exchange the truth of God for a lie, he says. And we're left ignorant and confused about our identity, about our function, and therefore about our sexuality, and we begin to affirm and promote that which is a violation of truth. And so he says in the end of verse 32, they not only continue to do these very things themselves, but they also approve of those who practice them. God's wrath is expressed in letting us go down this road of our choosing. And the sexual distortions of our world, according to this passage in Romans 1, if I understand it properly, are simply evidence we're living under the wrath of God. Not that we deserve the wrath of God, this is itself the expression of his wrath. With all the enormous pain and brokenness that goes with it. If that's sexual impurity, the other two, very quickly, he talks about material idolatry. It says in verse 25, they worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator. Because if the Creator is not the center of our lives, we cannot be left with a vacuum, because nature abhors a vacuum. And so we put into the vacuum created by the neglect of the Creator, created things. And this is called idolatry. It may not be initially obvious, but in due course it'll become so, because he speaks in verse 23 of creating images made to look like mortal man, birds, animals, and reptiles. When people's center of their lives moves from the Creator to created things, to material things, when people's goals in life become the accumulation of things, when we measure our value by our possession of things, when we attach virtue to the possession of things, when we get up on Monday morning and are driven by the race for things, we are living under the wrath of God, is the message of Paul here. Notice they worshipped in verse 25 and served created things. What you worship, you serve. What you serve, you worship. What motivates you? What gets you out of bed? What gives you your meaning? He says created things replace the creator. This is very difficult for us because this is normality in our culture. We're too sophisticated to call this idol worship, but idolatry is replacing the creator with the created. In light of this passage, I think it's probably true to say historically that when materialism is God, sex becomes the goddess. And history shows that when nations and peoples are materially prosperous, they usually become spiritually indifferent, and then they become morally bankrupt, and the moral bankruptcy then destroys the material prosperity. And it's a cycle. It was true of the Roman Empire. It has been true of other civilizations through history, and it is true of the Western world. And it will decline. It will implode. Because our prosperity is created an indifference, which has created a moral bankruptcy, which in itself is destroying our prosperity. And the third thing, sexual immorality, material idolatry. Third thing is personal indulgence. Particularly, he talks about intellectual arrogance. Because in verse 21, though they claim to be wise, having rejected the truth and replaced it with lies, although they claim to be wise, they became fools. Because they didn't follow the clues through the creation and conscience that implanted within them, they only had a human perspective to fall back on. And according to the human perspective, they became wise. In actual fact, in the big picture, they became fools. Because in the absence of God, in our thinking and perspective, verse 21 says, their thinking became futile, their foolish hearts were darkened. Though they claimed to be wise, they became fools. You know, wisdom in the Bible has little to do with intelligence, and foolishness has little to do with lack of intelligence or IQ. Wisdom and or folly have to do with disposition. And our disposition, our attitude to life has to do with what we do with God. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, the book of Proverbs tells us. And this is Paul's argument, and this is his diagnosis of our world. On the basis of the exchange of truth that God has given to us in creation and in our conscience, we have failed to take that revelation, partial though it is at that point, and begin to follow it through logically. And so our minds become darkened instead of enlightened. We become foolish instead of wise. And we are given over to our willful, corrupted behavior sexually, materialistically, and egotistically. And he sums it up in verse 28, where God gave them over to a depraved mind. And I won't read verse 29 to 32, but you read that sometime. And there are 22 different things there that he gives as symptoms of this depraved mind. Without any exaggeration or any mock sensationalism, I'm not into any of that, we can hold this up as a mirror to our society. Paul could have been writing to us and said exactly the same things. We are living under the wrath of God. He's given us over. As a society. But what is true of society is only true and is true of individuals. And if you choose to be here with a nice smile on your face on a Sunday morning, but go back home to live in sin, you're kidding yourself that you're getting away with it. You know, the first time you sin willfully, deliberately, you can't sleep at night. Your conscience is screaming at you. The next time, you'll get a little bit of sleep. It'll shout at you. Your conscience will shout at you. The next time, your conscience will talk to you. The next time, your conscience will whisper to you. And you'll think, I'm getting away with this. God doesn't seem to mind. He's not causing me to wrap my car around a tree. No, he's letting you go. He will let you go. Unless and until we come to a point of recognizing the truth about that, confessing it and repenting of it. But there's one last thing. Because if there is the present expression of the wrath of God in that it is being revealed, his wrath in the present tense, there is, of course, an ultimate expression to God's wrath. And we will talk about this later in chapter 2. But he says in chapter 2, verse 5, you are storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath when his righteous judgment will be revealed. You see, it's not to say, well, look, I'm in this sin and actually I'm enjoying it. Yeah, I know it. There's a few negatives, but it's too good to let go. Don't think that's the end of the story. There is coming a day of God's wrath. There's coming a day of judgment. Chapter 2, verse 2 speaks of God's judgment against those who do such things as based on truth. Verse 5, you're storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath. Verse 6, God will give to each person according to what he has done. Verse 16, this will take place on the day when God will judge men's secrets. Notice, secrets. There's coming a judgment day. We'll either stand before God covered with the righteousness of Jesus Christ, or we'll stand alone under the wrath of God. You know, the problem with sin is not that it distorts my life. It's not that it messes me up. It's not that it makes me a slave. It's not that it leaves me with scars. All of that is true. The problem with sin is it provokes the wrath of God. If it just messed me up and was a problem to me, well, then you can try and overcome it. You can get some counseling. You can try to resolve it. But none of those addresses the key issue. Sin provokes the wrath of God, and no counseling deals with the wrath of God. And that's why we have the cross of Christ, because we not understand the cross of Christ until we understand the wrath of God. The cross of Christ addresses smack on the wrath of God. And we'll see that in a couple of weeks' time. How and why. All the wrath of God on sin is channeled to Jesus Christ, so that if I am in Christ, I am sheltered and I am safe. Because now the wrath of God has been channeled into Christ, all his righteousness can be channeled into me. Now, this is just a diagnosis that Paul has been giving here in the verses we've looked at. And we have to get the diagnosis right if we're going to begin to find the solution. And we will talk about solutions. But don't wait till then. If God, the Holy Spirit, is convicting you this morning, there's an old chorus we used to sing. Some of you will know it, many of you won't know it. There's a way back to God from the dark paths of sin. There's a door that is open, and you may go in. At Calvary's cross is where you begin when you come as a sinner to Jesus. Let's pray together. I don't know what has gone on in your own heart in these last 45 minutes or so. I don't know what has been provoked. I don't know what indignation may be aroused, what anger may be aroused. I don't know what conviction may be brought. But some of us need to talk to God and say, God, I'm sliding down a road and you've handed me over. It's getting easier and I justify it more and more. And you need to stop and confess and repent and trust. Will you do that? Lord, I pray for every one of us in this building. We are very conscious of our sins, our failures. But I want to pray for those who have given up the battle against sin. They've adopted their sin. It's become their friend. Become their pet. They love it. I pray, Lord Jesus, you'll wake us up to see it as it is, to see its consequences, to see that sin is and can only be destructive, and bring us to the cross of Jesus. We might know forgiveness and cleansing and renewal. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in next week for another message from Charles Price, The Judgment of God. The book of Romans reveals the answers to important questions and provides information on many topics such as salvation, the sovereignty of God, judgment, spiritual growth, and the righteousness of God. In Paul's beloved letter, he makes some tough, unashamed statements about God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a concrete theological foundation for their faith. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call +1 416-222-3341, extension 113. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character?
Many times in my childhood, we traveled so far, and by nightfall, how weary I'd grow, and Father's arms would slip around me, and gently he'd say, my child, we're going home.
caught a glimpse of that heavenly land. Praise God, I am going home.
But now twilight is fading, and the day soon it shall end. Oh, I get homesick the farther I roam. Oh, but the farther he has led me each step of the way. And now I am going home, for I'm going.
I'm going.